What would you say is the biggest, what the biggest impediment to your success has been in the past? And I gave some examples, not enough groups in the coalition, not enough money to get message out, not enough time to organize, picked an unstrategic bill, author did not support bill enough, too many entrenched interests working in opposition. Maybe just in summary form, what you think were the biggest impediments, everybody. 30 seconds or less.
30 seconds. Okay, so Measure B, like I said, we lost by 12 points. Biggest impediment, likely people's understanding and knowledge of public banks. It is not a common piece of knowledge that everybody, every voter has about the purpose of banks and the purpose of banks in government. So we had very little time to prepare for that. We did have a plan to educate folks around this state bill, but our partners at City Hall jumped the gun, I think, and put it on the ballot too early. Now, not everybody in my coalition agrees with me, so I'm not speaking on their behalf, and we do have some very important allies, which are necessary when you want to pass legislation in positions of power. However, they are not reliable ideological allies, and so you need to always handle your relationships with elected officials with a grain of salt and understand that they have different motivations than you, even when they say they share the same. So I would say that education and shared information is the main thing that's in the way of public banks, but then being able to have reliable elected officials in positions of power is also very important.
I would say the biggest impediments would be the complexity of these four bills, trying to explain that. It's a big, heavy lift, and that's why I created a website where I could refer people to go and sort of look at their leisure. We're basically trying to close all the loopholes that allow charters to spread without any sort of check on their proliferation. The other thing is that people like to, they like their one lovely little mom and pop charter school to be the exception to the rule. So there's a lot of resistance among progressives even, that, you know, my little charter school can't be bad. Well, unfortunately, it's the business model. And so I think another impediment is that people have a sentimental and or naive sense of what public education is. They have warm, cozy feelings, but they aren't willing to dig down and say, hey, there's a political economy to the public administration of this public good, and that is where the charter people have seen opportunity. So I really see that as an impediment.
Yeah. So Prop 59 did pass, but it passed by 54%. If we'd had $100,000 more dollars, we had $130,000 total on a statewide ballot measure in California. Our pollster, Tom Steyer, paid for a poll for us, which is a whole other story that I can tell you about another time. But what we learned there was that if we had another $100,000, we would have gone to 75%. So we would have passed with a feather. The greatest impediment, apart from money, and this really was a bigger impediment, was media. What Lauren's talking about. Why would corporate media talk about this issue when they benefit from it should be broken up? It should be all those same little outlets. My dad was in advertising, and I grew up knowing how many outlets you could have. Oh, my goodness, that was fast. Okay, so media.
So I think the biggest obstacle is still an uninformed electorate. So for those of you that know about single payer, please spread the gospel to anyone who will listen. And I think so that's the first thing. And then in the end, we don't have a Republican problem here in California, we have a corporate Democrat problem.
Yes.
And I hate to constantly harp on that issue, but that really is at a core why we are not able to get things. Yeah. Finally, I'm just gonna say one last thing about that. There is a mod caucus in Sacramento, and they get press, and they talk about how they're going to keep, but there is no progressive caucus in Sacramento. Can you believe that? Despite the fact that we're supposed to be this progressive legislature, there is no progressive caucus.
That's because they have no progressives in the
caucus. So I think that, I think that that says a lot about why organizations and get-togethers like this are so important to keep this message. Thank you.
Okay, the final question, and I'd like the audience, whoever has questions for the panel, to start lining up at that mic while they answer this final question. And this is where I put the panelists on the spot, because the first part of this question is easy. Do you see the value in forming a coalition of coalitions, such as the California Progressive Alliance, and becoming a bigger progressive force to deal with our mutual opponents, the established moneyed interests? And this is the putting on the spot part. Would you be willing to devote time to the following things? Contacting your members about issues unrelated to your main purpose, jumping on a monthly conference call with other issue campaign leaders, advocating for legislation unrelated to your main purpose when you are doing voter outreach, either via phone banking or door-to-door canvassing, and what other ideas do you have for how the CPA can be most effective?
All right, I'll start with the hard part first. I do think that coalitions like this are really important. I think that this is how political parties start, and I think that in the end, you either need to take over one of the two major political parties or create a new one with a line that all of us can agree on. It's democratically chosen and not influenced by outside corporate interests. Yes, I'm more than willing to get on to represent California Public Banking Alliance around public banking and to coordinate with other issue candidates. When we were going through Measure B, we were pushing real hard for housing initiatives that were on the ballot at that time because they aligned perfectly with what we're doing. It's easy for me to say yes because public banking integrates very well with everything else. It's a lot harder if you're trying to convince people about the Clean Air Act or something to also bring up single payer because you also need to have focus in your conversations. It's not always possible, but there, you know, we do have to make an effort to reach out. I think that groups like mine need to do a much better job of reaching out to communities for urban development, for racial justice. You know, there's a lack of queer activists here, as far as I can tell. So, like, there you go. So I think that's another element, is that we can't be satisfied by just calling ourselves progressive and seeing who shows up. We have to actually go out and make space. That's an active activity. And then, what was the about CPA? I think that's it. We're good. Thanks.
Okay. I am all for CPA. The California Democratic Party does not have an education caucus. I think people think like, well, the unions. People think like, oh, well, the union's got it. It's all handled. Well, I think there needs to be a space of people who are in favor of unions, pro-labor, but at the same time, have another power base, right? Community people, people without children have a stake in like not being ruled by stupid people.
I asked you a very specific question. Are you willing to?
Yeah, totally. Okay. And I also expect, the big thing I would say is I expect reciprocity, right? So like I'm out there on your issue, you better be there on my issue. So like I wanna see 300 signatures from this conference on reformchartershools.org. Because I think that is like the minimal lift that you can do, okay?
Thank you.
So MOVI does work on other issues, largely because money and politics touches every issue. So we're very open to that. To David's point, I think when you're doing outreach to voters, you should talk about one thing because you confuse people. But apart from that, yes, but you would create other phone banks to do that. And I just can't reemphasize enough Paul's point about what has happened in Sacramento as far as the absence of progressive champions. And I think that may be a result of the jungle primary, and I think that was Charlie Munger's idea, was to move the progressives out of the way and get the moderates up the up into the Capitol. And I was speaking with Holly from San Francisco at lunch, who told me that in San Francisco they have ranked choice voting. So I think that might be something that this coalition might start with to do statewide, because that would transform it, in my opinion, almost instantly.
I think absolutely. When I was at the Courage Campaign, we tried to do this within the first month of taking over. Governor Brown tried to do a prison expansion, and it brought an unprecedented coalition together of people that normally didn't work with one another, because they realized if $700 million went to prison expansion, that was money that was going to go away from early childhood education or healthcare or other things. So I do think that none of us here are single issue voters. I think we're all progressives and we care about a lot of different things. Bill Honigman, Dr. Bill, are you around here? He's right in the back. He, you know, he's a physician that does a lot, but also with PDA, does a tremendous amount of work on other progressive issues. And I think that one of the things we're trying to do among the physician community is to get more white coats at non-medical events for social justice. And I think that's what we all really, really need to work together.
Okay, we have only 15 minutes for questions.
Hi, my name is Roxanne, and I'm the first transgender woman to get a vote in the Democratic Party, so I want to say thank you to the good doctor. No, I'm bringing that up because I think that should be an embarrassment to the Democratic Party that not one of us is employed in Sacramento, not one of us has a vote, and they stripped my state vote, and I'm fighting to get it back. But Medicare for All is also important for our community because we have no coverage, no health at all, and Medicare for All is the only way we're going to get it. So thank you, doctor, for your good work.
Yeah, two questions, David and Paul. Paul, first, because it's easy. Do we have any sway with Governor Newsom as far as, like, 7, because so did they expand it?
So Governor Newsom has been very open and willing to listen to the single payer community. Roseanne DeMauro, who was the former head of the nurses union, has been talking to him regularly about single payer and sort of expectations to put people on the council. So I do think a lot will be telling by who he appoints, obviously. But until that happens, we do believe there will be quite a few pro-single-payer people on that commission.
Yay. And then, David, coalitioning postal workers and letter carriers, have you guys been working with those unions for public banking, for postal banking?
Yes, yes. The Postal Workers Union has been vocal in their support of expanding postal services to include short-term credit and checking services. At their locations, yes, it's huge. They have a huge amount of real estate in every single zip code, and postal banking is a huge part of what we think a federal public banking solution will include. Obviously, it's not a state issue, so it's not a part of what we're doing, but all of our work would create banks that would easily integrate with those kinds of postal banks.
Hi, my name is Kane Randolph. I am a disabled rights activist and some guy extraordinaire. My question, I guess it's a general question, but have you used adversarial politics such as Cynthia Nixon versus Andrew Cuomo, and would you continue to use that as well or in the future?
Well, we have a really great enemy in our movement, and it's Wall Street. And we get to just mention them constantly, and we basically use them as our main foil all the time. Nobody likes Wall Street except for the California Bankers Association.
Basically threaten an elected official's seat, like Cynthia Nixon threatened Andrew Cuomo's governor seat, and so he moved left on a lot of issues.
Well, you know, we did that. Let me speak to Elizabeth Warren, who we call California's own Elizabeth Warren. She was running for state assembly down in San Diego's District 76. And she was an activist with Move On. I met her on the TPP coalition calls back in 2012. And she ran against a woman by the name of Tasha Berner Horvath, who was an establishment Democrat. She was on the Encinitas City Council. Perfectly nice woman, but it was clear that she was going to go along with Anthony Rendon's agenda. And they ran hit pieces against Elizabeth Warren, an independent expenditure committee, encouraged by the establishment Democrats in San Diego, funded by the SEIU, and Planned Parenthood had a hand in that. Basically, 5 hit pieces against Elizabeth Warren. So we have tried to run progressive activists against establishment Democrats. Maria Estrada is right there behind you. The problem is we have problems within our own ranks, and I will say establishment unions and establishment NGOs. So that's the problem with trying to do that. We've tried.
Yes. I would like to make it a litmus test that what kind of Democrat are you if you're taking money from the Charter, you know, California Charter Schools Association? Why are you aligned with Betsy DeVos? That is essentially her you know, agenda, right, is to privatize schools and basically diminish, if not eliminate, the public school system. So I think it's time. I think it's time to bring it to the party. I think it's time to bring it everywhere we go. And, you know, where it really matters is in the endorsements, and that's why I'm kind of pushing the ADEM issue, because if Tony Thurmond had not had the California Democratic Party endorsement, if Marshall Tuck, the corporate Dem, had had it, we might have Marshall Tuck as the state superintendent of public instruction. So I'm ready to make it a litmus test.
Yeah. And Marshall Tuck was literally laughed off the stage at the convention when he was seeking the endorsement of the party. I just want to highlight, too, to everyone what Speaker Pelosi did this week, which was to try to require a pledge that anybody who was working with anybody who was going to primary a Democrat was going to be blacklisted and not they would their campaign consultancy services would no longer be accepted by the Democratic Party. So that's a giant problem. I'll just leave that where it is.
This is a statement in regards to what we're doing as progressives. I think there's a disconnect in communities like mine. There are no Our Revolutions, and no clubs or groups or anything like that. I'm actually going to do a quarterly newsletter in my district and the surrounding Southeast LA to bring attention to certain issues that affect us. But like this whole convention, it would have been really good if we had someone who could translate in Spanish and it was live streamed so that people could see it. Latinos are the biggest voting bloc in the state, and I think we're missing that. People didn't know about SB 562 because we don't go in those communities. Like Lauren said, progressives are in silos and they're in bubbles. And because we all talk and we all know who Kevin De Leon is and we all know who this person is, they have no idea. People are just working, trying to get by and pay their bills and take care of their kids. So we need to be able to make that connection in communities like mine. And it has to be where we have Spanish-speaking people that are on the ground with every issue that you guys brought up. We need your help. I need your help to get that information to my community so that they could come out in numbers for you.
Hi. I think that we need to rethink the way we talk about corporate power. It is not really corporate free elections. It's not money out of politics. We are in an age where there is a hostile corporate takeover of every single American political institution. And you want to talk about a litmus test? How about the taking over of criminal justice, anybody who takes money from private prisons? Yeah. We need to rethink that. And the San Diego Progressive Alliance is just starting on a project. It's going to be a pamphlet, maybe like Thomas Paine. You know, great ideas, right? But it's going to be a pamphlet to widen the way we talk about corporate rule, way beyond corporate money or getting money out of politics. We're talking about corporate control and decorporatizing our democracy.
My name is Isaac. I'm a registered nurse and environmentalist and longtime political activist. And I have two quick questions, one directed at Paul Song and one for Michelle. Thank you, by the way, so much for what you guys are doing. I loved hearing that the polling for Medicare for All or single payer is tracking well with the marriage equality. When we share that, yes, the question is, can you please remind everybody that tens of thousands of people are dying every year because Medicare for All has not been passed, and so we need to make this go as fast as possible. The curves look good, but we've got to light it on fire. Michelle, thank you so much for what you are doing. Money is not speech. Corporations are not people. And the Bill of Rights was written for people. So as we get this Citizens United overturned, can you continue to work for clean money, full public campaign financing, and addressing the issue of five Supreme Court justices who pretend they believe that the Bill of Rights was written for corporations? Impeachment should be on the table for Supreme Court justices. Thank you.
So I appreciated what Matt Gonzalez said earlier on about needing to work on those really foundational issues that really are barriers to all the different kinds of issues that we're talking about. And you've also started to address that, talking about ranked choice voting, getting money out of politics. But one of those foundational issues that I don't see people talking about, or actually that's my question, is anybody working on this, is overturning the voter-led initiative that created the open primary, but at the same time only puts forward the top two vote-getters so that after the primary there are no Greens, there are no Peace and Freedom candidates to drive those discussions and push the Democrats further to the left.
Hi, my name is Rosie Zepeda, and I ran for city council in San Jose, and I didn't win because I'm not a millionaire. But here's what I want to pose to everyone in this room, including the panel, because it's been brought up over and over again. It's money in politics. So this is what I would like everyone who has a network and the panelists who you're in a position already of driving the train is I think we need to shame politicians, and they will come out of this website to show who are the main corporate sponsors, and we drive that message over and over and over again until we turn the tide that there's no PAC money and there's no corporate money.
Hi, this is to Michelle, but to everybody. It was proposed earlier that there be a litmus test about prison money and charter school money. How about just saying, I'm not going to accept corporate donations, period.
Hi, Mike Feinstein, former Green Mayor in Santa Monica. Thank you. And my question is, in addition to trying to get money out of politics and advancing things with ranked choice voting, do you see a role for actually using proportional representation elections to have a full multi-party democracy, and should that be part of the Progressive Alliance approach? Thank you.
Okay, so pick the question that you most want to answer. Each person, if you have had a question directed to you, did you?
Yeah, so as to Assemblymember Rivas' point of view that our bill will die, it is not going to be easy to pass a bill that allows cities to open public banks. And, that prediction may or may not be true, but it does not mean that we would stop our effort. I do see our bill as being potentially a part of a California Green New Deal. I think portfolios might be a way to get initiatives through, especially in election years when you can turn it into a litmus test. But I also think that you're correct that if we wait until next year, all of our issues will fall to the wayside, and suddenly it'll just be a Democrat versus Republican question, and all of us will be called traitors to our nation for asking about the specifics. So I think this is the year to establish AB 857 as a potential victory, and if we have to push it for another year, get it into a budget, we will. But I do think that urgency is pretty important. And so I would encourage you to contact your assembly member and tell them that they're wrong and that we will pass it.
So I just wanted to answer Maria really quickly. Reformchartersschools.org. We're working on being trilingual, so we have a Spanish language petition that we're about to update. We have Mandarin Chinese in simplified and traditional, obviously English, and I think we're going to try to add a few more languages, but I am deeply committed to like multilingual, multicultural kind of organizing for sure. And then with regard to propositions, I think there are some risks and maybe we need to think about the strategy of that, but I did want to add, I am totally down with Prop 13 reform, and that is on the ballot. But I do not want to go into that and flood the system, the public education system, with money and still have charters. There to gobble okay? And the other thing is the equity piece. What is the point of flooding the system with money if you are buying more school resource officers, police on campus, when kids are saying, we need to stop the school push out, we need to stop the, you know, kind of little mini mass incarceration thing that's going on in the schools, okay? So there's always the equity piece in addition to the fully funding.
So there was a bit of a jumble of things coming at me, so I'll start with the Supreme Court and say that in our view, there are four illegitimate members of that court. So, you know, that's the George Bush never won an election, and the Supreme Court said they weren't interested in counting votes, right, of an election, and that's how we got George Bush. So that, to me, was our original PTSD moment. So that is something that we are hoping ultimately to address. As far as public financing, our position right now is we're working in Los Angeles to increase the matching funds for public financing and lower the contribution limits. So we think that's going to happen this year. You may know that SB 1107, which passed the legislature a couple of seasons ago, which would have now made it so that it was no longer illegal to have public financing in California. So that's a stumbling block. A lot of people don't know we have. It did pass in the legislature, but it's failing in the courts. And so that remains. But my personal feeling about this is, while I love it on local levels, because I think it can have a huge impact, statewide or nationwide, at this point, as long as super PACs still exist, it's just going to be another way that public money is going to be used under this guise that we have public financing, when in fact it's going to be the private money that will still control what happens and what our policies are. So not quite yet statewide or nationally, but absolutely let's work on it at the local level. Thank you.
Real quickly, with regard to some sort of initiative for single payer, I think, again, we have to do a better job of really educating our electorate before we do that, because when we even had insurance rate regulation, the insurance industry outspent us $50 million to $1 million, and it got resoundingly defeated. You can imagine how much money they have from all the denials they've done for our healthcare and jacking up our pharmaceutical costs. They have stockpiles of money to just spread lie after lie after lie. So if we don't do a good job of really educating our friends and neighbors and coworkers, we're not going to stand a chance on any type of initiative.
Thank you. Let's give another round of applause to this great panel. All right.